All right, fantastic. Hi, everyone. Welcome to the 2020 virtual State of Search. My name is Casey Markey. I'm the founder of Digital Consultancy MediaWise based in San Diego. Very excited to be with you today. I've been a loyal State of Search participant for many years. I'm going to be doing a presentation today called the Outlander Guide to Content Auditing. So just follow along with me and then I'll be back and we'll do a Q&A hopefully if we have some time left. So continuing here, this is again a little bit about me. You can follow along online at MediaWise with Twitter. You can drop me a note on Facebook, or you can send the occasional pork good or craft beer gift as well if you like the presentation at the end. There are a lot of blogs and bloggers. A new WordPress blog is created about every half second. That comes out to about 172,000 blogs a day and bloggers. That is a lot of noise. There are over 600 plus million blogs worldwide, and there are over 31.7 million active bloggers in the United States. That adds up to an exceptional amount of content. The average user sees about 285 content pieces every day. So, unfortunately, most of that content is crap. This is a great cartoon that talks about that in detail. I know many of you are familiar with content marketing, but we're going to be covering the topic of content auditing today. We necessarily want to be able to show what the best content looks for, what it looks like, how we can identify it, and in some cases, why removing poor content can help a site leap forward algorithmically. Now, when we're talking about content, we want to look back to the Panda algorithm, which was introduced in 2012. The old questions about improving after Panda are useful today because of their core. They're about improving content, not that they are Panda specific. Our algorithm is designed and gets improved to better reward good content, end quote. This is from Danny Sullivan, Google Liaison, responding to a question about what users should look for when they're surfacing highest meets and needs content, especially in light with the increase in core web updates, supposedly, that have been happening over the last couple of years. And he says, go back to Panda. And that's really what we're going to be doing today. There were 23 questions initially introduced way back in 2011 with regards to Panda. And these questions allow site owners like yourself to assess the quality of a page. And they're great. They involve things like, is this a piece of content free of spelling errors? Does it ask and answer questions that the user is going to be interested in? If you want to step into Google's mindset, which is again the whole point here, the questions provide some guidance on what Google's looking to do when they say our goal is to surface highest meets and needs content. And I've provided a link here to that initial blog post and those questions, so definitely check those out if those are new to you. Well, let's talk about EAT, because I know a lot of you are familiar with that concept. You've heard it in the news. It seems to be everywhere these days. EAT stands for expertise, authoritativeness, and trustworthiness. And when we're talking about content, we're also talking about the experience and vetted authoritativeness of the creator of that content as well, the trustworthiness of the creator. We want to be able to actually be able to trust the user whenever possible. And that goes hand in hand in the content a little bit. So definitely understanding what that is will help you. As I said, we're going to do a little Outlander theme today. For those of you who are not familiar with Outlander, it's a book series by Diana Gabaldon, and I have been forced to watch a lot of it with the missus while I am on house arrest or lockdown. So I figured that I would share that with you today. This is Claire and Jamie Fraser. They're married now. If you follow the books closely, you'll find that they have quite the journey, so to speak. And in this case, and we're talking about a little comical element of EAT and about how she's a doctor, but of course they're in the 18th century. So women as doctors are completely frowned upon. And Jamie's reminded her, well, last time you killed a guy by drilling a gaping hole in his head to relieve cranial pressure. And it's pretty funny when we talk about EAT. EAT can, in many cases, be how others respond to your content. Now, regardless of that, understanding EAT is great, but don't lose any sleep over it. Google has said repeatedly that they do not have an EAT score. These Google Quality Rater guidelines are really where they want the algorithms to go. They're as a check, so to speak, on what we want to see show up in the algorithms over and over again. Now, it's also been found out that over the last several months, especially with these updates, EAT is mostly about inbound links and citations. And unless you're your money or your life site, this shouldn't be an overwhelming concern for the average blogger at all. Content is a good king. but not all of it. Here's another quote from Danny Sullivan. If you want a better idea of what we consider great content, read our Raters guidelines. So type in Google Quality Rater guidelines into Google. There was just a recent update here in about the midpoint of October. That's the first update we've had in a while. Well worth your time to review those. I know it's a little dull reading. You can always do a search function. For example, I do a lot of work in the recipe niche. So clearly I would go in, I would type in recipes, and I would look at all the different places recipes is referenced in the Google Quality Rater guidelines. That's a very simple way to kind of qualify your time, make things a little bit more easier to digest, especially if you're niche focused like I am. The good old all you need is good content spill. I'm tired of your blethering. This is another character in Outlander. You can look him up at your convenience. But this is John Bell, spoiler. And this is just, again, when we talk about all you need is great content, I know that many of you have heard this over and over again. I know many of you have told this to your clients. And I wish it was that easy, but there's a lot more to it. And again, going back to the concept of EAT, many of you may know Marie Haynes, a nice, well-known SEO based in Canada. She and I go way back. We've done a detailed review, a webinar here on SEMrush that covers understanding and optimizing for the Google Quality Rater guidelines. And we cover great examples of bad content and great examples of good content during this webinar. And it's well worth everyone's time to take a look at that. I provided a link here. Now, what does great content look like? I mentioned previously that my focus these days is on the food and lifestyle niche. I do a lot of work with recipe bloggers specifically. It is probably 90% of my business. I've audited literally thousands of food blogs and most of the top sites in the world. Everyone from, this is a good example. This is Recipe 10 Eats with Nagi. She's based in Australia. She gets around 12, 13 million visitors a month with regards to a food blog, which is pretty darn high. You can kind of see here at the top of what we're looking for when we're talking about great content. You see the breadcrumbs, the date stamps, the jump buttons so that users don't have to scroll down through large pieces of information or ads if they're in a hurry. We always want to tie all of our content to the author so we have a linked byline. See the clear author. There has been a trend online, especially with designers, to remove sidebars. That's completely terrible advice. There, we could talk about that for an hour, but just understand with sidebars, especially for users, sidebars allow you to push EAT. They provide an ability for you to do a lot of internal linking. They actually show you and provide a way for you to use embeds and multiple call to action so that you can build up email lists or push products, supposedly. There's a lot of reasons you would want to keep a sidebar. In many cases, also, when we remove sidebars, we're removing strong internal linking signals, which is always bad. A lot of people think, well, Casey, what about, you know, you can't see a sidebar on mobile. Hey, the sidebar's still there. It's just at the bottom of the page. We haven't removed it, and therefore the links are still there. And even though we're at a mobile first index where Google is really using all mobile signals, I'm definitely against removing sidebars for many, many reasons. So what you did not see on this was ads. Ads above the fold on desktop should be discouraged completely. No value to having them. This also extends to mobile. We always want to focus on UX first always. Now, here's another example of where, when we're talking about content, we always want to have dates on our content. That's another highest meets needs characteristic. Bloggers, again, many of them have been told for years, we don't want to put a date on your content because that would work against the, you know, evergreen nature of content. You know, most content is not evergreen, and that's a problem. We want to communicate that. Put a date on it. Google's clear that they want to see it. There's clear advantages. I recommend the use of both last updated and published dates whenever we can. Most content, again, is not eternally evergreen. Users in Google want up-to-date information, both usability and freshness, so we add published and last modified dates whenever we can. Now, here's a great example, especially in the recipe niche, again, that I work with, ingredient shots. This is an example of where bloggers have started to include labeled photos of the ingredients into these posts. And that this is a very highest meets needs approach. This is great. It allows users to communicate I call it the toddlers and drunk adults approach to content marketing, where our goal is to dumb down everything as much as we can so that if someone is going through the store and they're looking for a recipe on their phone, they can just look at the photos and say, hey, I'm just going to pull out these ingredients as I'm walking down the hall here. And whenever we do focus groups, this is the kind of stuff that users just go crazy for. So definitely be understanding that a usability first approach is the way to go. What we don't want to do is have the same photo over and over again. I know a lot of you on the call use stock photos. Well, as you can imagine, stock photos can be reprinted on many other sites over and over again. And I see that a lot. I've actually seen an increase of that, not only in the recipe and the lifestyle niche, but elsewhere as well, especially in the travel niche. Your goal is to make sure that you're using unique photos whenever possible. If we're actually putting a recipe post, for example, I do not need 6 photos of the cheesecake from different angles. What I might want to have, though, are detailed step-by-step process shots showing me how to make that cheesecake as when at all possible. So again, photography, very important. But when we talk about highest meets content and content auditing, photos are also something you'd want to take into consideration, making sure that they're all unique whenever possible. Quality content writing. We want to keep it simple, stupid. This is the KISS method for content writing. We want to write for users, not to a word count. We want to use subheadings, H2s, H3s, etc., especially for accessibility purposes when we're optimizing for those with a possible disability. We have one H1 on a page, then we have H2s for the subheadings, and then very occasionally we might have H3s or H4s under those H2s. We get into a lot of trouble with bloggers who use headings incorrectly. They either try to use headings because of font size reasons, so they'll jump from an H1 to an H3 or H4 because those are smaller font size, but that's an accessibility violation. We don't jump H tags whenever we can help it, or H headings, as we call them. You would never have an H2 without an H1, and you would never have an H3 on a page unless it was preceded by an H2. Short 2 to 3 sentence paragraphs. We always want to show where we're going with the content. We want to show the user how to make something. We want to show the user the benefits of the content. We want to show the users why our opinion is the only opinion that matters. We want to use process shots. We want to use detailed photos that tell a story. We don't want to have the same photo all over again. And we want to dial the ads back. So if you're running ads on your site and you're running the recommended ads from your ad company, I can tell you right now without even looking at your site, that is too many ads. Never go with the recommended settings from your ad companies. Always go about 20% smaller at a minimum. And of course, remove all above the fold ads as much as you can. We've seen situations where, especially lately, as we're going into the holiday season, bloggers are pushing things like gum ads, which are image ads that go on the bottom of every image on the page. Those could be horrible for users. And it really inflates the number of ads you see on a page dramatically, which of course can kill your page speed and usability. Run less ads, make more money. That's always been helpful. Now, being relevant is no longer enough for blog posts or for content in general. We want to be useful. That's really the number one ranking factor. I want you to start thinking about how I can be useful with my content to my users. Can I take a unique approach? Can I answer questions that the user is really looking for? Does my content tell a story? But is that story useful to meeting the needs of that visitor at that point in time? Using good tools is always helpful. Yoast is so hilarious because Yoast gets a lot of an undue rap because of all the updates that it does and some of the problems that it occasionally has. But there's a reason Yoast is 10 times the market share of every other SEO plugin out there. It does work well, and it has lots of really cool built-in features. One of them is an orphan content filter. You can see this here. For those of you who are not aware of orphan content filter, there's another version of it here in SEMrush. An orphan content filter or an orphan content tool allows you to see all the content on your site that is not linked from any other content on your site. This is orphan content. These are content islands. Those are bad. Whenever we can add links to our content internally especially, that's one of the simplest and quick SEO wins you'll ever do with regards to content auditing. We want to make it easier for Google to find our content. And when we don't link to content, that's a poor internal signal. So there are two methods here, both with Yoast and SEMrush, that you can, of course, identify orphan content. And as I said, just by sending internal links to these posts, you can increase traffic dramatically. I've seen it. I am a site auditor by reputation and practice. It's all I do. And in many cases, just sending some links into what we call barren content or this orphan content will cause that content to be revitalized very quickly. We just ping Google, they come back, they grab the links. Hey, lo and behold, we've got some improvement there. Now, we also want to redirect attachment URLs and purge them from index. For those of you who are not familiar with attachment URLs, they are files that are created on WordPress, which contain nothing but links to the images, whether it's an image or a video file. There is nothing on these pages. They're literally the epitome of thin content. And if you do not set them up or redirect them, whether or not you're using Yoast or RankMath or all-in-one SEO plugin, you will have problems by flooding Google with low quality content. This is an example of a sitemap that has the attachment files open. And in this case, there's four sitemaps there. Each of those sitemaps has 1,000 files in them. So do the math. There is 3,000 plus thin content image files being flooded in the index on this site. And the site came to me and said, I don't understand what's going on. It's like, we have great content, but for something, there's like a weight pulling us down. Well, here is the weight, because what they're doing is they're wasting their crawl budget. They're requiring Google to crawl all these low quality image files. If I was to put one of these posts into Google and do a site's URL search on it, I would pull up all the images tied to the post. Those should never be visible in the search index. So we want to redirect that. So we use a plugin like this to purge them from the index called Yoast SEO Search Index Purge. Just removing this kind of thin, low quality content has really a very good advantages. It allows Google to find and surface our better content more easily instead of crawling me thousands of low quality results. I still see this in audits every week. Stop flooding your index. Now, a quick way for you to track changes is to use Google Annotations here. Here's an example of Google Annotations. I provided a link on the annotations how-to. It's amazing how many people never know that Google Annotations exists. Whenever we make changes to our site, we use annotations to provide a history of those changes in case we notice some traffic drops or we notice something's going on. We can go back previously, look at the notes, and maybe find out where the possible mistakes were made. I know, wonderful news. Jamie loves annotations, by the way. It's a fact. He mentions it all the time in Outlander. Definitely something you want to be aware of. Now, Google performs a lot of updates. I know many of you have seen this graphic here about Google makes over 3,200 changes a year in search. I can tell you right now that that number is substantially higher in 2020 already. So it's going to be interesting to see. All we have is Google's declarations about this. Otherwise, we just have to guess. Now, each day, Google releases one or more changes. Some of these changes help us. Some of these hurt us. We have to accept that. Google, we know that there's a lot of these changes. I hear this all the time. Casey, what can I do to insulate myself from these core updates or from these unannounced updates? And the fact of the matter is you can't do much at all. And that's just the world we live in. And it's just something we accept is that, you know, as every year there's a new list of top movies and top music and top videos and top cars, there is always going to be a new list of top sites on page one of Google, okay? Now, here is the core updates that we talked about briefly. Core updates, I mentioned before, they have wreaked havoc, especially in the last year and a half, 18 months or so. These are broad core updates by Google where they're big enough, they affect a large swath of sites that Google has to let us know that they exist. It's funny, Google says there's nothing we can do about these core updates, but as you can see here, that's not great news if you've been hit by them. We had an unannounced core update in November 2019 that decimated large swaths of food, lifestyle, and do-it-yourself blogs. Those same blogs were again hit in January when they have an announced core update, and they were hit again in May when they had the next announced core update. Now, here we are in October, and we have yet to have a new announced core update, although there has certainly been a lot of volatility. We've had issues with disappearing snippets. We've had issues with incorrect canonicals with Google. We've had issues where they've indexed different versions of content, and it's a shit show in many cases. So we're waiting. We're going to try to see. We expected to have a core update by now, but we're still waiting. And here's another character from Highlander or from Outlander who basically shares my opinion. It's been very bad, especially over the last month or so with regards to how Google is indexing content. There's a lot going on. They even had to remove the URL inspector, submit your URL tool from Search Console because people were using it so much. Things would drop out of the carousel, so they would go into Search Console and resubmit their posts, and they would blow through the quota, and it was causing so much demand at Google's end that they literally stopped that tool from working. Now, I have no idea when they're going to turn it back on, but good times for sure. Now, core updates have to have winners, and core updates have to have losers. Over the last several core updates, here's a very quick list of sites in my niche specifically where food, lifestyle, do-it-yourself. You can see that there's a trend here on the domains on the left-hand side. There's a lot of big sites there. Pinch of Yum, Well Plated, Simply Recipes. Some of the biggest recipe sites in the world had clear improvements. You can see below Betty Crocker, others. And then on the right, you can see that there's a lot of other sites here, mostly not as popular, but still very high volumes of traffic. And you can see that they have just been decimated. So what caused a lot of this? You can see Delish on there, Brown Eye Baker, others. Well, here's some of the takeaways that we found. And we did a whole report on this. I worked very closely with the professionals over at Top Hat Rank, which is a search engine, a digital marketing firm based here in Southern California. You may be familiar with Arsen Rabinovich. You may be familiar with Ashley Segura. They're both principals over there, longtime friends of mine. Salt of the earth. We put together a lot of data. We found that known brands got a boost. Sites with domain authority of 50 plus had ranking improvements. Sites with linking domains of 2000 plus. Page speed had little or no effect on improvements. Winners had strong EAT. Yeah, again, bigger sites got a little bit of a boost here, which was very interesting to us. It seems like their backlink profiles and their earned EAT insulated themselves from a lot of issues. Here's what we found with the losers. Losers had lower average domain authority and backlink totals. Please understand that domain authority in many cases is a novelty metric. Google does not use it, but again, it's a good comparison metric for our purposes here for StudyWise. Keyword over optimization, excessive on-page repetition, questionable backlink practices, excessive ads, bloated thin content. These are all things that as an auditor we're looking for and we're trying to correct, especially if someone comes to you and they said they've suffered a ranking drop, they're on WordPress, they're in a specific niche that's been impacted by these core updates. These are all things we're looking at. Here are what's been targeted by these core updates. First in November, again in January, and again in May. Huge keyword over optimization. See how keyword dense this is. I mean, whenever you hit a keyword at 4+%, you're going to be in trouble. It's hard to believe that here it is 2020 and we're talking about keyword density. Here's another example of a site that had overdone it with Apple Pie. We just don't want to do these kind of things in the environment that we're in now. Here's another one for ciabatta bread. As you can see, this is a great example of a big, big site that dropped from number one to number five for ciabatta bread. They probably would have dropped completely out of Google except that they had a huge backlink profile. Now you can see here, look at the headings on the page, see the H1, see the H2s. This is an incorrect and outdated antiquated way to use headings. No longer should you be loading up your headings on your page with keyword rich phrases like this. That day is over. Google has, with the use of BERT, with the evolution that they've done with natural language processing, with the ability to read forwards and backwards, with the amount of AI they're now using, this is unnatural. We do not want to be stuffing our headings with keyword phrases like this. And this is a trend that we're seeing evident in sites that have had clear and present drops in the search rankings. We just don't want to do this. So you should not be using your headers to repeat your keyword phrases, your focus keyword phrases, in an overboard way like you've just seen in the example here. Yes, Claire, I know. I don't want to have to tell you I like my content. I get it. I get it. But whenever we do a content audit and we find these over-optimization triggers, removing them is always going to be our first recommendation. So what is it, some examples of thin, low-quality, and expired content? Here is an example of a site that had 225 expired giveaways. None of these had generated traffic in years. They're just a drag on the site. We do not keep them. These are the kind of things that we would probably no index or at most likely delete. We want to use a Google site operator to surface these. We can use your site in content or in text giveaway. We can use in text raffle. We could use in text raffle copter. We could use in text sponsored, whatever, to surface all these low content issues. You also want to go ahead and use your Search Console to surface low content here, or low visited content. Here's an example on a site that we had where we would just pull up the last 6 months, and they have a startup blog resource. And as you can see, this thing has not had a click in 6 months. This is not the kind of stuff that we'd probably want to leave open to Google. Startup log resources are a dime a dozen. They're not going to help the site. Maybe we know index, but in many cases, we probably just delete it and get it off the site. Yeah, I know, Claire. This is no joke. Low quality content is bad. So let me give you a couple other examples here. Here is a blog that had a ton of best book reads. We're talking hundreds of posts here from 2016, 2015, older. This is like an albatross around your content neck. We want to remove all this stuff. It hasn't been read in years. People always think, hey, Casey, should I, you know, I'm scared to delete this content because it might have backlinks helping me. Well, folks, if the backlinks were helping this piece of content, it would have had a click in 4 years. So understand that you don't want to slave yourself to the backlinks coming into your site. If the backlinks were really powerful, you would actually not be considering deleting the content at all. So let's talk about cultivating the content garden, which is the meat of this presentation, which is weeds, low quality content, flowers, high quality content. So I have a whole tutorial on this. Should I remove content? Here's a link to it. I wish we had more time today, but I'm already coming up on it here. So we're gonna plow through the rest of these slides. Low quality content does hurt you. Here's a detailed response where I lay it out, provide links to quotes by Google, all about it. So Claire, believing something doesn't make it real, I agree, but this is John Mueller, direct from Google. He says, yes, absolutely. You should remove content. If you don't want it in the index because you know it's low quality, then removing that does help us understand the rest of your site better. Can't get any clearer than that, folks. Content auditing is the real hero. We don't want Jamie to die. He seems like he's always dying at least once or twice every season in Outlander. But hey, we don't want him to die on us because he needs to help us with content auditing. So the two truths about content auditing: not all existing content is relevant to your audience, and don't expect every single page on your site to rank. Now, here's an example of a site with the term is shit ton of content on their site with no organic traffic. You can see that there's 5,700 URLs here. Look at the small amount of content on their site that is absolutely generating traffic. In many sites, we want to look at the 80-20 rule. Usually 80% of our traffic is generated by 20% of our content, where in this case, you could see that it's more like 5% of the traffic, or, you know, 5% of the content is generating 80% of the traffic. So we really need to change that. And that involves going in and removing this plethora of low quality URLs. Here's an example of a site that we've done the content auditing on. You can see here that the only 113 URLs are receiving no traffic. Most of those URLs are paginated content, or maybe they're seasonal in nature. And in this case, you can see that the vast majority of the content on the site is generating URLs. This is a natural looking example of organic traffic overview. This is what we want to have for the average site. Now let's talk about content auditing using buckets. Bucket number one is content we want to update or republish as soon as possible. Seasonal content bucket two, update or republish when seasonally relevant. So right now we're in the fall, we're in the harvest season. Anything that would be related to Halloween, anything that would be fall related or pumpkin or anything that's coming up on the holidays, and that's content we'd be looking to update and republish right now. Then we have the low quality content bucket number three. This is content that we know is not doing anything for us. No clicks, no positive signals. We know index content or we delete it. So let's talk a little bit about the difference there. First of all, let's sort the content by no clicks. And you can see how we can do this by going into Search Console. Here's an example of where we can sort content by the last 3 months. And if they have, you know, 1,000 pages or so, or less than 1,000 pages, this is really easy. Then we can download all this content and then we can start sorting it. Maybe I can pull the graph, the information from Google Analytics, see if they have any social shares. But in many cases, this is a quick and dirty way for you to export your content from GSC, Google Search Console, and start auditing it. Now, in this case, I've exported it out. I can export out to 1,000 URLs. I can see that there's no clicks. This is all content that I probably want to start looking at. We can also add an Analytics Edge add-on. I provided a link to analyticsedge.com, which will allow you to expand up to 2,000 rows of Google Search Console data that you can export. That covers most smaller sites, especially. If you want something bigger, then you have to use something like URL Prospector, or you're gonna have to look at Screaming Frog or another piece of software that's gonna allow you to do a full content on it. Once you have a full export, I look at 90 days or about 120 days. I do a cross-reference, anything that has no clicks. I wanna see, maybe I no-index it, maybe I delete it. here's some content auditing pro tips to make this easy. Never no-index something you think you'll eventually re-index, because that's a confusing signal to Google. If I've got something that's been no-indexed for 6 months, it might take a while for Google to trust it. A 410 is always better than a 404 to remove indexed content fast. We have data showing that a 410 does get out of the index about 20-30% faster. There is no limit to how much content can be deleted at one time. This is a very popular question. Doesn't matter. Google doesn't find all that content at the same time. They crawl it at different times. Doesn't matter if you have 1,000 posts to delete or 100 posts to delete. I found that there's no difference in how Google treats that deletion. Just get it off your site when it's easier for you. Once you delete content, run a broken link checker to remove previous internal links. I recommend the broken link checker, the WordPress plugin. It works extremely well. It's been taken over. It's been fully enhanced. It's great. I have no issues. Or again, you can run something like Screaming Frog or another Sitebulb or some other piece of software you have. And finally, don't link to no index content. You waste internal link equity. When we delete something from our site, or when we no index something specifically and we're linking to it, we're basically sending that page rank down a black hole. This is why we tend to no index tags. But when we no index tags, we don't necessarily want to have site-wide links to those tags on our website. And I find that when we remove those links, we recover more link equity to flow back to the original page itself and the other more important internal links. Removing content can result in big traffic changes. This is just a very simple example where we started content auditing in March. We deleted almost half their content. Traffic immediately went up 81%. This is probably influenced, of course, by quarantine traffic as well, but nevertheless, they were very, very pleased. We had a small seasonal dip, but traffic is still up 67% year over year, even after the quarantine lifted up. Wish I had more time today. I've got a whole full webinar podcast on content auditing. You can see the link here. I definitely urge all of you to take a look at that. I know that this presentation will be available to everyone after. And now we drink.